Hachette Audio presents Hard to Handle, The Life and Death of the Black Crows, a memoir. Written by Steve Gorman with Stephen Hayden. Read by Steve Gorman. For Rosemary, my anchor, and Jim, my mentor. For their steadfast love and support, despite both my inability and my reluctance to clearly explain any of this as it was actually happening. All my love to you. Preface. A good day in the Black Crows was just a day that wasn't bad. My band, the Black Crows, had a hell of a run. But man, it was weird. Our first album, released in 1990, was huge. Our second album was also a success, and it solidified our place among the world's best and biggest rock bands. And then, things went sideways. Over the next 20-plus years, we lost about 90% of our original audience. A lot of that was by choice. We purposely avoided doing things that would have helped to grow or at least maintain our fan base. We did what we did, and we didn't do what we wouldn't, for better or worse. But here's one good thing about the Black Crows' self-destructive streak. It weeded out our casual followers and tested the resolve of our staunchest fans. In the end, the people who stuck with us really, really fucking loved us. And it's those people to whom we owe our career. Because of their support, the Black Crows were able to maintain a healthy touring business for decades. Years after Hard to Handle, She Talks to Angels, and Remedy came and went from MTV, we could sell out theaters from coast to coast in the 2000s and the 2010s, even as we continued to test the patience of our fans with a series of frustrating decisions and inevitable flameouts. When the band called it a day for the first time in 2002, the primary cause of our internal misery was the constant battling between Chris and Rich Robinson. From the day I met them, they fought. It's not like they got famous and suddenly couldn't get along. They were never on the same page. But they had the same last name, so they figured, well, we have to do this together, I guess. The sibling rivalry between the Robinsons was omnipresent, and it had simply run its course. We weren't young, hungry kids anymore. When we were first starting out, we were all more tolerant of each other's bullshit. At the very least, we could ignore each other's bullshit, pretend it wasn't as bad as it actually was, and then get on with our day. By the time everyone was in their mid-30s, it had gotten much harder to do that. The prevailing sentiment was, guys, fucking enough already. Why are you always fighting over the same shit? The brothers would always say, this is our business, don't worry about it. But that was impossible. Their nonsensical sibling rivalry infiltrated every aspect of the band's existence. Everybody else in the band and crew were pulled onto one side or the other, despite our best intentions to stay neutral and do whatever it took to keep the whole thing moving forward. It was exhausting. The Black Crows broke up in 2002, although at the time it was classified as a hiatus, which is a great word to use when you think it's over but can't quite be sure if that's the case. By 2005, there was a prevailing sense of, well, shit, let's do it right this time around. Everybody had, allegedly, grown up. And after experiencing reality outside the Black Crows, we realized that it probably wasn't as cool as life in the Black Crows. There was, initially, a very real and urgent desire to not repeat mistakes. Within 18 months, though, it was apparent that we were back on the same hamster wheel. Fight, tour, record. Fight, tour, record. People don't change unless they truly want to change. And the Black Crows didn't truly want to change. It felt very much like it always had. We're a really good band, but it's a total pain in the ass to be here. There will forever be one overriding truth about the Black Crowes. We were, at our best, a great fucking band. Many people loved the music we made. But enjoying that love was simply never allowed in the Black Crowes. It's frustrating that the band could never evolve to a place where there was genuine appreciation for all we had done, and for the fact that we'd found and maintained an audience. I can point a finger, and people can point fingers at me. Everyone has their own perspective. But the whole thing was tense, angry, and difficult. To be clear, there were a million laughs along the way, and there was at times a true esprit de corps in the Black Crowes. But many of those laughs and much of the bonding was fueled by denial and a desperate, gnawing fear of facing the toxic reality of our interpersonal relationships and admitting the consequences of our self-destructive decisions and lifestyles. Between 2005 and 2010, we made 3 albums and toured constantly. We found ourselves living through the same grind as before. And just as before, it became impossible to agree upon, much less maintain, a discernible set of goals. By December of 2010, the band had completely run its course. Chris had checked out entirely. He no longer wanted any part of a band in which he didn't call every shot. He needed to be completely in control, despite a lengthy track record of calamitous decisions and misguided efforts with very painful consequences. He put together a band called the Chris Robinson Brotherhood, and then, for the second time in 9 years, initiated a hiatus from the Black Crowes, intent on forging a new path that no longer required working with his brother. I went to see that band in 2012 in Nashville. He was actually smiling. He rarely smiled that way, so genuinely, when he was on stage with the Black Crowes. I thought, well, good for him. I hope he's actually happy. So I was surprised when, after the gig, he asked me about doing a Black Crowes tour in 2013. Why do you want to go back to something that makes you so miserable? I said, laughing. But shortly thereafter, plans were in full swing to tour in 2013 as a test run for an anniversary tour in 2015 to mark 25 years since the release of our multi-platinum 1990 debut album, Shake Your Moneymaker. The tour in 2015 would also most likely be a proper farewell to our loyal fans. We still had a few hurdles to clear. The Robinson brothers hadn't spoken in a year and a half. As our manager was putting the tour together, Chris and Rich were threatening each other in emails on a daily basis. I'll kill you if you do this. I'll quit the tour if you do that. And all that standard bullshit. At our first rehearsal in Brooklyn, the rest of the band was wagering on how long it would be before they actually came to blows. The over-under was 3 hours. During our first break, the two of them paired off and had a quiet conversation in the corner. To everyone's utter amazement, that one brief chat was all it took to bury the hatchet. We finished that rehearsal without incident, and then the next, and the next. We played 120 shows that year, almost all of them sellouts. Promoters loved it. The reaction from the fans was consistently positive. The brothers got along very well, at least initially. We were set up perfectly for the tour in 2015. We talked at length about putting out new music in 2015. Maybe not an entire album, but certainly an EP of 4 or 5 new songs. If 2015 was going to be our last tour, it was important that we not kill ourselves. Shorter legs, longer breaks. Let's do it right. Do it smart. Go out on a high. We made it about 2/3 of the way through the tour in 2013 before everything turned sour. No one saw it coming either, as shortly before things started to unravel, the brothers had grown closer than they'd ever been. Their father, Stan, died, and Chris and Rich shared their pain in a way that seemed to pave a newfound acceptance and appreciation for each other. The bond didn't last long. 3 weeks later, we had a 10-day break in the tour. When we reconvened in Portland, Maine, it was immediately apparent that whatever closeness they had developed had just as quickly disappeared. That break was all it took for Chris to decide he no longer needed his brother, much less the Black Crowes. We finished the tour as we had so many tours before, running on empty with all the screws coming loose. A year that had started with such promise and so much positivity finished on a note of relief at best, as well as profound sorrow at another lost opportunity. In early 2014, we played 4 corporate gigs: Las Vegas, New Orleans, New York, and Boston. Those were ultimately the last shows the Black Crowes ever played. Private gigs for a select few, instead of the grand anniversary tour we originally envisioned. After our last show in Boston, I shared a car to the airport with the Robinson brothers, the 3 founding members of the Black Crowes, taking what turned out to be our final ride together. We were on different airlines. I got dropped off first. "All right, fellas, see you later," I said. "Okay, see you, man," Rich said. I looked at Chris, but he didn't say anything. He was staring at me, a million miles away, staring through me, actually, with an uncomfortable look on his face. I stared back at him blankly. Again, I said, "Later, man." And again, nothing. After a few seconds, I laughed and said, "Well, all righty then." I climbed out of the car and walked into the airport. I texted Rich, who was still in the car with Chris. "He's about to blow this whole fucking thing up, isn't he?" I wrote. "What do you mean?" Rich texted back. "Look at him. He couldn't even speak to me. He's up to something." By that point, we all knew each other so fucking well. We couldn't hide a thing from each other. "Yeah, you're probably right. He's just staring out of his window," Rich wrote back, still sitting right next to his brother, wondering whether or not something dramatic was cooking in that drug-addled brain. A few days later, we got our answer. Chris's wife sent an email to Pete Angelus, our manager of 24 years, stating his demands for his continued involvement in the Black Crowes. Moving forward, Chris wanted 75% of all the band's income. That was quite an upgrade from the 33 1/3% share he had been receiving. It was apparent that our...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.